All right, people. Review of the week time. So, lot to talk about, an awful lot. And I think the majority of this is going to be on Dillian White, the fallout from there. He has released a statement, but there is still a lot that we need to find out before we can really go a little bit more in depth. I want to talk about some comments made by David Haye. We'll talk about what happened last night with Jake Paul. That's the only kind of real fight card we had this weekend. So not a great deal in that sense to talk about there. But we got to talk about Dillian White for starters. And we'll talk about AJ as well, how this affects him. So obviously it was about lunchtime yesterday. It was announced by VADA that Dillian White had returned adverse analytical findings in a VADA drug test, which meant, therefore, that his fight with Anthony Joshua was cancelled. The card, as of the time of recording, has not been scrapped. It's not been touched. And there hasn't been, at the time of recording. Now, it's 6:30 in the evening, Sunday. So I don't think they'll announce any opponent today. They may very well do that tomorrow at some point. Because we're ticking down. Like, we're on a clock now, so I would imagine if they are going to announce an opponent, it's going to be reasonably soon, within the next 24 hours, I would imagine. And that's going to be interesting to see what they do there. But Eddie Hearn did state that they are looking for a replacement opponent. He hopes that fight can still go ahead, or the card can still go ahead. Obviously, Dillian White is now out. And basically, Dillian White, he released a statement. So obviously, we read the Matchroom statement. There wasn't much to go by with the statement Matchroom and Eddie Hearn released. It was just stating that they were made aware. They made the decision to pull Dillian White from this fight, you know, which is the correct thing to do. So there's not, and again, they didn't give much away in it. So there's not really a lot I can do with regards to dissecting it. Like, at the end of the day, we can only kind of surmise. I would imagine they know the substance that Dillian White is reported to. Well, the adverse findings, let's just say, tested positive. Because Dillian White, in the statement he's had, has hinted that as well. He's basically said it, but we just don't know what it is yet. We can only guess, you know, it could be anything. But I'll quote Dillian White directly here. He says, "I am shocked and devastated to learn of a report by VADA of adverse findings related to me. I only learned of this morning and I am still reacting to it. I have also just seen that the fight is cancelled without having any chance to demonstrate my innocence before the decision was taken. I can confirm without a shadow of a doubt that I have not taken the reported substance in this camp or at any point in my life. I am completely innocent and asked to be given the time to go through the process of proving this without anyone jumping to the conclusion or trial by media." Before I carry on there, it's very interesting. He's like, "I can confirm without a shadow of a doubt I have not taken the reported substance in this camp or at any point in my life." They have not released what the substance is. So the fact that he's saying that, that implies to me that, I mean, God knows. Imagine, I'd say that obviously they have more information, but could you just imagine, we'll say it was an adverse finding for just higher testosterone or something like that. Just hypothetically say it wasn't a substance, and then he's mentioning a substance as if kind of like, you'd have people's like, wait a minute, we were only looking for, what substance are you on about? So he's mentioned, I'm only just surmising with that bit, but he's mentioned a substance there. We haven't been told, certainly for any of us, what the substance is, but Dillian White, and I would imagine Eddie Hearn and those in the team would know. He goes on to say, "I insisted on 24/7 VADA testing for this fight, as I have done voluntarily and at my own expense for all my fights for many, many years. This is not the first time that I have been reported as having an adverse finding for a substance which I have not taken. As I did last time, I will again prove that I am completely innocent. In the meantime, all I can do is express my extreme disappointment to the boxing fans who will miss out on what was sure to be a great event." That is what Dillian White has said there. Very, very, very interesting. I really, truly don't know what to make of all this now, to be honest with you. I really don't, because there's not been a lot come out. Dillian White is hinting that he knows what the substance is, and I would imagine that those around him, obviously Eddie Hearn and Matchroom DAZN, probably Joshua as well, would know. We obviously don't. But he's saying he's not taking it. I mean, Dillian White, this is the third time he's had issues with drug tests. You know, it's not like this is kind of out of the blue, first time kind of thing happening. It's the third time. Now, I know the first one was that, obviously, Jack 3D, which he failed for in 2012. Some people could say that was a little bit harsh because it was an over-the-counter supplement. It hadn't long been taken off the banned list. Dylan White was not the name then that he is now, in a sense of he was fighting on small hall shows, so he was not going to be in a position where he could really, you know, have people looking at what he was consuming and stuff like that. But at the end of the day, there is the catch 22 where you should say, well, it is strict liability regardless where you are in boxing, whether you're at the bottom or whether you're at the top, it is still strict liability, which is true. He was hit with a 2-year ban, and I suspect that if he had been a bigger name, it would have been a lot lesser than that, I would imagine. Maybe nothing would have happened, who knows. Then obviously he had the issues with UCAD, and bear in mind these were UCAD, not VADA, back in the Rivas fight. Now, the Rivas fight is an interesting one because, by all accounts, Team Rivas were not made aware. So, if I remember correctly, he was tested positive before the fight, but no one was made aware until after the fight, which really is very questionable. I mean, that really is... that's a real bizarre decision. Obviously, Dylan White was later exonerated and left fight again. But now we're in a situation where something with a drug test has come up again. Obviously, it's with VADA this time, not UCAD. I would imagine that, given the fact that, look, at the time with Oscar Rivas, Dylan White was very much an A-side fighter. He was headlining shows, pay-per-view shows at the O2. I think now where he is, and given the fact that this is his third time, I would imagine, and again, I'm only surmising, but I would imagine if it is for a performance-enhancing substance, that he probably will get banned this time around. And you could argue that maybe this is the end of Dylan White, because he's 35 years old now, he hasn't been looking particularly good, and a 2-year ban now could really spell the end. I mean, it really could for Dylan White. All we know is, for now, he's not going to be fighting Anthony Joshua. I want to go and read this statement here from David Haye, which he told Radio Raheem on Seconds Out. So, he has claimed that Derek Chisora told him a week ago that Dylan White would have a drug test issue and that he would jump in to fight Anthony Joshua instead. He said, and I quote here, "It's funny, I got a call from Derek Chisora about a week ago telling me this exact thing would happen. I didn't pay much mind to it, but he was telling me he's fighting AJ a week ago. He's fighting AJ a week ago. Derek's been training for that fight." I'm just trying to like piece that all together. A few things. One, for the love of God, I don't want to see Derek Chisora versus AJ. Please, for the love of God, no. I don't want to see that. Look, David Haye talks a lot of you know what. He does. And David Haye, I get the impression, can be easily led astray. He strikes me as someone who, if he's told something, especially by someone he knows, he just takes it as gospel. Do you remember a couple of years ago in the run-up to the Canelo Khan fight, where I think Amir Khan was saying that he was weighing like 170 pounds outside camp, and David Haye was going around saying, "Oh, Khan's bigger than Canelo." It's like, use your eyes. He's clearly not, like, you know, just because he said it doesn't mean it's true. And he's telling everyone that Khan's bigger than Canelo. "Oh yeah, he's bigger than Canelo." I was like, no, he's not, mate. Seriously, just leave it. He's not. So David Haye, I think, could be a bit easily led with regards, like, his friends telling him stuff, like Derek Chisora, and then he'll think, "Oh yeah, that," and they'll come and say, "Oh, he's right, it's this." Maybe Chisora's winding up, I don't know. It's hard to really say, but I did find it strange that Chisora was added to this fight card so late in the build-up, if you get me, because, you know, it does happen from time to time, but you're talking the guts of 10 days. All of a sudden, Chisora and Washington pop up, and you're like, that's a bit strange that it's just now, rather than a couple of, like, a month or so. I know there's not been a great amount of build-up for this fight, but they've had fights announced from the get-go with this, and that one was just so late. I was kind of like, that's a bit strange. If that is what, look, I'm not saying there's any validity to what David Haye is saying here, but if it is true that Chisora knew a week in advance that this was going to be an issue, surely Team Joshua and Hearn and DAZN would have known. Surely. You know, and again, I'm only surmising with this. I'm not saying for definite, you know, Cesaro knew this. I'm just surmising. I'm just saying, well, if he did, surely Eddie Hearn would have known. But with this, look, I don't know. I would take that with a grain of salt from David Hay, you know. It's a strange one. And for the love of God, please don't do Derek Chisora versus Anthony Joshua. Please, whatever you do, please don't do that, because it's not a fight that I particularly want to see. I don't think the majority of fans want to see it. I don't think it's worthy of pay-per-view. I think it's a terrible fight. I really do. I think it's absolutely god-awful. You know, in terms of Anthony Joshua and who he will fight, as I said in the video I did yesterday, okay, as I said in that video yesterday, Hrgović is the best fighter on that card, apart from Joshua. You would think that, like, you know, if Eddie Hearn wanted to do, like, a big event or a big, you know, keep it on pay-per-view, that would be, as a fan, people would be saying that's the logical fight. But the promoter, it makes absolutely no sense. I mean, like, it's not even, let me take into consideration, Hrgović has a world title shot guaranteed, right? And he's risking that, fighting Joshua. Joshua has the Wilder fight and all that, and he's risking all that to face Filip Hrgović. You know, if he loses, I mean, that's just, you know, that, what do you do? Like, what, realistically, what do you do? So for Eddie Hearn, DAZN, everyone, it just makes no sense to do that fight. Washington, I've talked about Washington before, and I've said I wouldn't necessarily mind it, you know, as a first comeback fight. I thought it would have been, you know, fair enough. He would have steamrolled him, but maybe he needs that. Would it give Joshua, like, the boost to think, yeah, I'm back to my old self, you know, I'm a knockout machine, if you fought him where he's literally had a fight on a week's notice? Because he's only been announced for this Chisora fight 10 days ago. So how much notice did he really have? You know, it's not like you're fighting a guy who's had a full camp. And let's be frank, he's lost, I think, two or three fights by knockout. So it's not like he's coming into this fight on good form. I know Franklin lost his last fight, but he went the distance with Dillon White. Many people feel like he won. That's very different to being stopped. I'm pretty sure it's been two or three times. I know he's lost Charles Martin, and he lost to some other guy in his last fight. But I don't know if there was another knockout loss in between there. I'm not too sure. But he's not been on good form. They've been knockout losses, not points losses. So I wouldn't particularly like to see that fight. Just at this point now, especially so close with everything, and the track, they might try and keep it on pay-per-view. I mean, if Jermaine Franklin isn't going to get fought, you're not going to fight him on pay-per-view, you shouldn't be fighting Gerald Washington on pay-per-view either, if that is the case. Andy Ruiz put his name forward. So we've seen a few fighters put their name forward for Anthony Joshua. There's been a few. So there's been Andy Ruiz, there's been Michael Hunter, and there's also been Otto Valine. I actually watched an interview with Otto Valine yesterday, where he was talking with Andy from Boxing News, and he was saying that, yeah, you know, basically, look, he'd think about it, he'd consider it. He's even been mentioning the fact that, you know, he's actually training for a fight in September, so he is ready to go, essentially. So Otto Valine versus Joshua. You know, Otto Valine, I've always thought Otto Valine is not a particularly bad heavyweight. He's not an elite heavyweight. He's not a world level, but he's probably fringe world level. I think some people say that he's only kind of European. I think he's better than that, but I definitely think he's been living off the Fury performance for way too long now. I mean, it's been 4 years since that Fury fight, and he's done absolutely nothing since then. You know, he's literally done nothing. So he's been living off that fight for a long time. And yeah, look, he did well. He won rounds. He cut Fury up real bad. Legitimately, it wasn't a head clash. It was a legit punch. But Fury won the fight handily. Like, he did. He had to work for it. And he had moments of success in that fight, Valine. But for the most part, it was a Fury fight. And he's been living off that now for the last 4 years. To be fair, he has tried to, you know, fight some of these guys. He has tried to do the Dillon White thing. And obviously, they announced that fight for October 21 in the O2. It wasn't Otto Valine's fault. Dillian White pulled out. That is what that is. With the benefit of hindsight, that really could have been a banana skin for Dillian White. Like, it's already a tricky fight, but with the way he looked against Fury and he's looked subsequently, that really could have been a big banana skin for Dillian White. Big time. And again, like, that's not Otto Valine's fault that he couldn't do that fight. And he, again, he's done nothing since then. Him against Joshua, I'd be still favouring Joshua, certainly if it's Aveline on a week's notice. We don't know what kind of shape he's in. I know he's training for a fight, but, you know, is he at the start of camp? Where is he? So, Aveline Joshua. See, the reason why I'm kind of like, Aveline Joshua is because I don't think that'd be a compelling fight. I think it would be a very tricky, very messy type of fight, even if he got Aveline at his peak. And I don't think it would be the most engaging performance from either man. I don't think it would have fans on the edge of their seat. It doesn't really benefit. Like, if Joshua was going to fight Wilder next, you're fighting a 6'5" southpaw who, you know, moves. Like, it's not Wilder at all. Like, out of all the fighters that I can think of, you know, Washington probably would be stylistically not really similar to Wilder. I mean, they're very hard to find a stylistic fighter like Wilder, but he would be kind of out of a batch of heavyweights. That's the one you could kind of say like has similarities, you know, and dimensions anyway. That's really it, you know. I mean, like Chisora is 6'1" and he's a pressure fighter who sits on the ropes. That's like the not Deontay Wilder, lads. It's completely different. So if you're fighting someone, and again, you can say Dillian White is not like Deontay Wilder, that's a fair point, but you would think they'd want to try and get someone to mimic-ish Deontay Wilder, you know? And you never know, like, when you look at heavyweight fights happening on short notice, especially when someone like Anthony Joshua is training for a very different style, you know, they get the contrast in one, it can make for actually quite entertaining fights. I mean, a good example would be, what was his name? Was it Kirk Johnson was meant to fight Lennox Lewis? Pretty sure it was Kirk Johnson was meant to fight Lennox Lewis, and for whatever reason, I can't remember the ins and outs, but basically Vitali Klitschko, who was meant to be on the undercard, had to step up and fight Lennox Lewis. Now Kirk Johnson is about 6'1", 6'2", short heavyweight. Lewis was preparing for that, and he wasn't preparing at all really, because he came into the fight heavier than usual, not much heavier, but a little bit heavier, and he definitely didn't look himself. You know, he wasn't taking Johnson serious. Vitali Klitschko was preparing for someone shorter than him, and he fought Lennox Lewis, who was shorter than him. And Vitali Klitschko was by his own admission, obsessed with Lennox Lewis. So he was watching Lennox Lewis constantly. He was always imagining what would be happening if it's my moment. Well, he got his moment, and we all saw what happened. It was a tremendous fight. You know, Lennox Lewis obviously won that horrific cut. I tend to think if Vitali Klitschko had never got cut, that Lewis would have still won. I tend to think that would have happened. I think Lewis would have still got to him. But I mean, that fight, if you've never seen Klitschko Lewis, it's probably the last great heavyweight fight up until the post Klitschko era started. Because there wasn't really any good heavyweight fights during the Klitschko era at all, really. There were very few. Not really any. And that was a tremendous heavyweight fight. And realistically, I would say in terms of heavyweight title fights, I'm going off a bit here, but just bear with me. I would say in terms of heavyweight fights, in terms of great heavyweight title fights, Vitali Klitschko Lennox Lewis is the last great heavyweight championship fight. Up until Vladimir Klitschko fought Anthony Joshua. So 14 years nearly. That's how bad the heavyweight division was in the height of the Klitschko era. There was no real big fight with any of the champions. Well, it was only the champions were Klitschko, so there wasn't anything like that. The contenders were all garbage. When they fought Klitschko, I mean, they were either overweight or small or both. It's just a nightmare. So that is something that can, and Joshua knows all too well what can happen when you take a fight or someone comes in on short notice. It can go wrong, big time. Joshua knows all about that. So I think Team Hearn, Team Joshua, the Zone Matchroom, they're gonna be wary about, you know, what happens next, you know, who they pick, etc. Because you pick someone, they could be a revelation. You know, you just don't know. So I think that's pretty much all with regards to the whole White Joshua situation. I'll probably do a live stream at some point tomorrow and go over it a little bit further. We'll hear from some of the subscribers, see what they think in the comments and stuff like that, and talk about it a bit more there, because there's a lot to still dissect. And obviously more information is going to come out. We're obviously going to get another opponent announced, whoever that may be. And yeah, we're going to have an all look-see and see what happens. In terms of some of the other things that happened, obviously Jake Paul beat Nate Diaz over the weekend, unanimous points decision. Nate Diaz, you know, 38 years old, had a really, really tough career in MMA, but probably made some money fighting Jake Paul. You know, I don't really, you know, I like, at the end of the day, like, with the YouTube boxing, I don't mind it per se, or influencer boxing, if that's what you want to call it. I don't really watch it myself. I don't really have any interest in it or any intrigue in it. There have been some fights that have interested me. You know, Jake Paul, Tommy Fury. But apart from that, it has not really been anything else. Like, I don't begrudge people if they want to watch it. At the end of the day, if that's what you want to watch, that's what you want to watch. I don't normally tend to cover it because, as I said, it doesn't interest me enough to make a video and discuss it. And, you know, that's me. But I am adamant that it is going to benefit the main boxing game. It has to. You know, I heard Outmatch on his live stream yesterday, because Outmatch, obviously, his background is in S&C. He works with, you know, amateurs and stuff like that. And he was saying that there are a lot of amateurs who are up and coming in their teens. When you ask them who your favorite boxer is, they'll say KSI or they'll say Jake Paul. So it is having an impact on the next generation. It is doing that. And at the end of the day, isn't that not a good thing? You know, if we have another Terence Crawford come along, you know, and he turns around and he says, what got you into boxing? And he says, Jake Paul, Tommy Fury. As far as I'm concerned, then that's a good thing, because we have another talent. We have a very good talent to watch and follow his career. And he got influenced into the sport by the influencers. Whether you like it or not, is that not a good thing if it's helping to grow the sport? At the end of the day, I don't really care for it. If I talk about it, it's because I'm intrigued in a particular fight, you know, or I find it, you know, comical, like that Boogie and Wings thing, you know, which was just, for me, comical. You know, what's not to like? Two fat, absolute barrels trying to box, it's funny. What's not to like about that? But I didn't obviously do a video on it, but I did watch that fight because it was fun. I knew it would be comical. What's not to like about that? But I understand there are purists who say, no, gee, we don't. And I understand where you're coming from, but is it not good if the scenario I just told you, where in a couple of years' time, we have people coming into boxing and making stars of themselves and them saying, oh yeah, I came in from Jake Paul. Is that not a good thing? Jack Cartrell has announced that he will face Jorge Linares at 140 pounds in Liverpool on October 21st. Wow. Linares, really? Cartrell? I mean, no disrespect to Jack Cartrell, but there's only so much long you can live off that Josh Taylor performance. He's really going to have to do something, because I don't find Jack Cartrell's fights particularly entertaining. He has Sam Jones managing him, and I think he needs that, because Cartrell is not a character that really, you know, how would I describe him? He's not the most charismatic individual, so he's going to need a lot of marketing help, and he can't live off that Josh Taylor performance forever. Against Linares, ugh, you know, I'm done with Linares at this stage. You know, I think his last real performance that he had in him was against Devin Haney. I think right now it's just going to be a case of, you know, like what? I really just, I don't know. No, that's a fight that's announced. Terence Crawford has declared that he will likely retire from boxing soon. I'm about to be 36. I don't see myself continuing to box very much longer. I've been doing this for a long time. I always said I'm going to retire from boxing before boxing retires me. That was on TMZ Sports. Doesn't surprise me. Doesn't surprise me at all. He's done pretty much everything he wants to do. I would say we're probably in the twilight of Terence Crawford, unfortunately. I reckon another two or three fights and we may see the end of him. Not in terms of him regressing as a fighter, but just calling it a day and saying, thank you, boxing's been good to me, but let's go, let's see you later. It wouldn't surprise me at all if that is what happened. In terms of Crawford versus Spence, it reportedly did 650,000 US pay-per-view buys. It's claimed that both fighters made at least 25 mil from the fight. Damn, 25 mil. 650,000 pay-per-view buys, not bad. I kind of had a feeling it wouldn't top over the million. even though it's a great fight, it was kind of like, probably won't top the million. But 650, I mean, that's pretty good, you know, for those guys. You know, Crawford, I think his, I don't even think he's, I think when he fought Postal, didn't that do less than 100,000? Pretty sure that did when he fought, that was on pay-per-view, remember that? Him against Postal, pay-per-view. Lord have mercy. They put that fight on pay-per-view. Madness. In terms of other news, there's not, like, it's funny, like, last week, up until they announced, well, up until Dillian Whyte had his adverse finding, there was really very little to go on in terms of news. There wasn't much going. I seen that Francis Ngannou has now appointed Mike Tyson as one of his trainers. That'll really help. Yep, because there's a list of people wanting Mike Tyson to train him. I've just, that fight, I swear to God, it just, whenever I read it, it's just like, is this actually happening? Like, is it actually really happening that we're getting Tyson Fury, who's a current champion, against Francis Ngannou? Really? You know, madness. And, you know, some people are like, you know, they're like, well, Joshua, why are you saying that it's okay for Joshua? You know, I know it's short notice and all, but why are you saying it's okay, like, to fight someone like, you know, a Gerald Washington? And it's like, well, one, I'm not saying, I'd rather he didn't fight a Gerald Washington for a variety of reasons. One of them is that I don't think it should be on pay-per-view. But I don't think he should fight Washington, because Washington hasn't had enough notice and he's not coming off the back of any good performances. So I don't know how it would benefit Joshua. But would I be, you know, how would I say it? Would I be, you know, saying, this is unacceptable? No. Because at the end of the day, Joshua's a contender. You don't have to hold a contender to as high a standard as a champion. You know, because Joshua as a contender, if Anthony Joshua came out and said, I want to fight once a month for the next year before I fight Deontay Wilder, and I just want to fight Cream Puffs. I don't care how much I get paid. I'm going to fight the last Saturday of every month for the next year, just fighting Cream Puffs. Go ahead and do it. You're not a champion. You're a contender. Do what you like. But as a champion, you obviously can't do that. You're champion, for God's sakes. You're holding everything up. You're holding the division up. You either vacate the title if you're not going to defend it, or if you're not going to unify it and move on, let the division, you know, keep going. But look, that is what that is. We know what we're dealing with. And it's like that in other divisions. I mean, look at Charlo. I mean, the WBO are going to strip Jamel as soon as he starts the Canelo fight. Fair enough. Jamal has no fights lined up at all. And the fights he's talking about are at the weight above, and he still has his belt. Madness. Absolute madness with the WBC. Never seen anything like it. It's just bizarre. I mean, it really is. Could you imagine? I know this is a flimsy analogy. It's a very flimsy analogy. Could you, like, imagine, right? It's a game of darts, right? They have the world championship every year. Right, Michael Smith is the darts champion. Imagine Michael Smith says, I don't want to take part in the tournament this year. I'm not going to defend the title. So instead of, you know, players playing for the title, they just say, well, we'll have a world championship, but there's no title on the line. It'll roll over till next year until Michael Smith is ready to defend it. That's basically what it's like with the WBC. You know, it's like, stop holding things up. Let the division move on and just, you know, don't be holding it up, basically. But now the WBC are like, do what you like. Do what you like. Unless we don't like you. In which case, then we're going to be strict. Then we're strict, you know. I'm watching yous, but all yous over there, it's grand. Tyson Fury, relax, relax. A mandatory, haha. Well, that's not our job to find him a mandatory, haha. Oh, it is? Well, I can wait. I can wait till Monday, 52 weeks from now. That's the WBC for you. That's Sullivan. In terms of everything else, I think that's pretty much it. Like I said, there was not a great deal of news coming. Obviously, we'll talk more tomorrow on Dillian Whyte. If there's more fallout, if we find out any more about the substance he was popped for, if we find out who Joshua's opponent is going to be or what's going to happen with the card, obviously, we'll talk about it. That's 100% a given. So, yeah, for now, I'll leave you with that. I hope you enjoyed the video, people. Smash the like button if you did. Hit subscribe, of course, if you haven't already. For now, lads and lassies, I leave you with that. We had a very good week. Again, 100 subscribers. That's 100 subscribers every week for the last 3 weeks. That's really good going. It's really good going. I'm very impressed with that. And we're not far off 12,200. We're not too far off. We're less than 50 away from that. So let's try and do it. 4 weeks in a row, 100 subs every week for 4 weeks. That's incredible. Since we hit 10K, the channel's been just going and going and going. 15K, lads, for the end of the year. Next year is the 20. Imagine that, 20K in a year. Holy man, that'd be crazy. 20K. 15K is still amazing. But yeah, it's incredible. Like, it really is. It's mental. Thank you to everyone who likes the videos and watches. I appreciate it greatly. You're helping me out immensely and immeasurably. You really are. I appreciate everything. We'll talk more in the live tomorrow. As for now, lads, I hope you all have a great week. Enjoy yourselves. Bank holiday week in Ireland this week, or weekend in Ireland this week. So if you are celebrating it, I hope you enjoy it. For now, I'll leave you there. Peace.